And there were a lot of weddings, I understand, this weekend. My nephew was married in Doswell yesterday in a church that was built in 1822 as an Anglican chapel. And my brother said, I don't know why everything is so old here in Virginia. I said, well, it's just the way history is, Brad. But there's a lot going on this week, and we'll start the announcements. It's a new month, and it's a new challenge for the hundreds. And thank you, Catherine and Chip, for doing some of this, and all of you for donating. It's Thanksgiving items this month, so bring those in. There's a blue bin in the fellowship hall for that. And they do appreciate this very, very much, the serve people in the Haymarket Pantry. And the next date is November 9th for the egg casserole. That's the delivery date. And there's our two little eggs blinking at each other. And you're invited to join the adult Bible study every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, which is meeting in the Rice Room. And they're studying the Wesley Prayer Challenge, and books are available if you need one. The next is our Wednesday night with Pastor Catherine, the Bible study. It's October 16th, and it's at 6:30. So please come for that as well. The next Sudley Supper is being held for Trunk or Treat, and that is the 30th, so it's not in the middle of the month, it's in the 30th, so you can decorate your car, your trunk, come in your costume. Fred and I will probably come as two soldiers, maybe, I don't know. Maybe. He's both sides now, Union and Confederate. I never know who's going to show up. The Church Bazaar, if you haven't picked up one of these, pick one of these up. They're on the blue table. I put one up at my mother's place and already got a lot of interest in it. So this is a wonderful thing the church does and has done really for over 100 years with the bazaar and not the dinner. They still ask me about the oyster turkey. And I'm like, maybe one year we'll do that again. So come for that, contribute to the white elephant if you have things. Women of Faith have prepared vegetable beef soup. And it's in the freezer, I believe, and if you want it, it's available today. I need to buy some, Sally. I gotta do that. Oh, I'll get mine today. And there's a special All Saints Remembrance Service, November 3rd, in honor of the members who have passed away since All Saints Day. And if you know of a member who has passed or have a close family member, please fill out one of these prayer cards that are here, and we'll include it for that event. Upcoming meetings. We have a trustees meeting today after church. There's a lot happening just today. And then we have a funeral for Wallace Hook that's at 2 o'clock. The church council is invited tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Again, these are open meetings. If you want to know what's going on at Sudley Church and the church family, please come. It's a wonderful time, really, of fellowship and knowing things that you say, what is happening? We'll come. You know, we'll talk about it. We'll come and talk. And the charge conference is November 4th, that is here. That's what Catherine said earlier, it's a time of celebrating what we've done and we still can do. So it's not so much a business meeting for that, but it can be. Let's bring in the light of Christ. If you please stand for the light of Christ, thank you. Hear the words of the prophet Jeremiah, Jeremiah 29:11. Jeremiah was living in exile with the Israelites nearing the end of their 70 years in captivity in Babylon. So they were nearing the end of this time. It was about 600 BC. He says, and he wrote, "For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future and a hope." And the prayer and praises this morning are exactly that, for prayer, for hope, and for healing for several of our members here. And for Doris Henning's daughter, Erin, we remember her. We also pray for Jennifer Milosevic's twin sister, Gretchen, in need of God's intervention with family issues. So we pray for Gretchen. And then we're thankful for Adam Wetzel's father, Leroy, who is doing well. I understand, Adam. Praise God. That's wonderful. Jeremiah went on to say, he says, "Then you will call upon me and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes." Would you pray silently with me for a minute, and then I'll close us in the Lord's Prayer. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings of this life that we take for granted, for our health, for our welfare, for our houses, for our children, and for our parents, for our jobs. We thank you that you provide all of that, and that you continue to look after us and to be over us all the time.
Good morning, everyone. Do you guys have a phone at home or even with you? Well, I have a phone here, and it seems like a lot of people have these. As you probably know, it has a built-in battery, and it has to be recharged. You can't do much with it if the battery runs out, right? Can't even call anyone. Well, what do you have that needs to be recharged at home? Maybe your iPad or your laptop, right? There's a lot of things that need to be recharged. And you know, people need their batteries recharged too. We work and play hard, and if we don't get enough rest, pretty soon we just don't have enough energy to do the things we need to do. All right. You see, just like that, I've had to power down because I need to be recharged. Even Jesus had to recharge. So today, we're going to learn how he did that. As you listen to what happened, you're going to use your arm to tell me how charged you think Jesus' battery is. All right? So if it's all the way up high, it's going to be a full battery, right? If you move it down, up or down, depending on if the battery is being used or recharged. Lowering it all the way to the floor indicates the battery life is completely out. All right? You guys ready? You're going to indicate the battery charge throughout my story. So Jesus traveled all around Galilee, preaching, driving out demons, and healing people. One day, Jesus and some of his disciples went to the home of Simon and Andrew. All right, where's Jesus' battery right now? Yeah, probably about the middle, right? But he was driving out demons, so maybe it's pretty low. All right, moving on. Simon's mother-in-law was there in bed with a fever. Jesus took her by the hand and helped her up. All at once, the fever left her, and she began to prepare a meal for everyone. Wow. So he was casting out demons, and then he healed someone. He had already healed a bunch of people, too, and he'd been preaching all day. Where do you think his battery was? All right. Well, let's see. Let's see what the next part of the story says. So that evening, many people came to Jesus to be healed for all sorts of diseases. The whole town gathered at the door to watch. That must have been a really long day, right? So where is Jesus' battery now? Yeah, we're probably all the way to the floor, right? Okay. Well, Jesus got up the next morning before sunrise, and he found a quiet place to pray and recharge his spirit. When Simon and the others woke up, they found him and said, "Everyone is looking for you." So where do you think Jesus' battery is now? It just says he prayed and recharged his spirit, right? So I'm sure it's pretty full. So Jesus had recharged his batteries and was ready to go. He said to them, "Let's go to other towns and villages so that I can preach to them too. That's what I came to do." So they traveled throughout the region of Galilee, and Jesus preached in the synagogues and healed people and cast out demons. All right, so if he cast out demons again and he'd been walking a long way, his battery's probably all the way to the ground again, right? Okay, you guys can put your hands down for a minute. So if Jesus thought it was important for him to recharge his spiritual battery, it's important for us to do that too. That's why we should spend time in prayer every day and come to church each week. All right, now you guys are going to tell me where your spiritual battery is, okay? All right, so show me. Go ahead. Well, those are all pretty good, right? Of course, you are at church right now. So is your spiritual battery that every day? So maybe we need to take some time, right, in the morning or even at night, and pray and just recharge our batteries, okay? All right, let's pray. God, help us to remember that just as our bodies must be renewed by proper rest, our spirit must be renewed by spending time with you in prayer, Bible study, and worship every day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I sit there and smile at your video the entire time you're doing it. It's lovely. Thank you so much. And just as we have received Katie's offering of a children's message this morning, so now is our time to present our tithes and offerings to God. And yes, I know I forgot again. I think maybe. No, I'm on. So I would invite the ushers to please come forward. And please be mindful that God blesses us so that we might be a blessing to all others. And this is a wonderful time for that act of worship. Thank you. Go. It's okay. We joyfully and gratefully give back unto you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing. It was a trick, right? For the reading of the gospel. And do you know why we stand for the gospel reading? Because as We know that Christ is the living word made flesh. We stand to honor his presence among us and the reading of his life story. So, hear God's word from the Gospel of John, the 21st chapter. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to the others, "I am going fishing." And they said to him, "We'll go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples didn't know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" And they answered him, "Nope." And Jesus said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. Now this was the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Eternal God, in my speaking and in our hearing, let not my words be heard but yours, and let your people hear what they need to give them strength and courage for the days to come. It's in the name of your Son, it's through the power of your Spirit I pray. Amen. Now be seated. This morning's reading is typically part of a larger piece considered during the Easter season, right? But you know, sometimes we just kind of rush through the readings when there is so much in each part of it that we need to hear all year long. So I thought it might be nice to consider John's gospel and what it has to offer us. After all, Easter is all about renewal, isn't it? And I thought we could use some of that Easter message about now. So let's go. Can you imagine being one of the disciples? Following Jesus had started out as something amazing. All the miracles they had witnessed, the transformative teachings they had heard, the feelings of love and affirmation and trust that the Lord had showed them. But over time, tensions between their master and those of religious authorities had made them so fearful. They were extremely concerned about going to Jerusalem this particular Passover. Peter had even tried to convince Jesus not to go. After all, Jerusalem is that city that kills the prophets. Well, Peter's counsel didn't go over really well, did it? You remember, Jesus turned and looked at him and said, "Get behind me, Satan." Not something you really want to hear. Thomas, he knew what would happen if they did go. But he said, "Fine, let's go and die with him." They were so anxious, but they chose to face their fears and go. After all, Jesus was leading them, right? And he'd never let them down before. He'd always taken care of them, so let's go. So as they approached the city,
they were met with a surprise. Because in the inner Jerusalem, their initial encounter was not with the religious authorities, but it was with a parade of people that seemed to get it. Maybe Jesus knew something those disciples didn't know. Maybe finally everything was going to go the way they hoped. Maybe now others would see Jesus the way they did, as the Messiah who's come to save them. Maybe now he's going to put all those religious leaders in their self-righteous places. He's going to get rid of the oppressors in Rome, and they are going to be in the top where they belong. Yeah, but the week continued. And Jesus gave incendiary speeches. He overturned the money changers' tables, and that's never a good thing. The final straw, he raised Lazarus from the dead. And now he is in irrevocable trouble. There were too many witnesses to that resurrection or that revival, and the religious authorities decided enough is enough. Not only need to get rid of Jesus, we need to get rid of Lazarus as well. Destroy the evidence as well as the one who's the root of the problem. And we know the rest. Jesus was arrested, endured an illegitimate trial, was crucified under Pontius Pilate, died, and was buried. And yeah, the disciples said, I told you this. We knew this was going to happen. And so they hid. They hid in the upper room where they had last eaten a meal with him. They hid and they waited, but what did they wait for? They weren't waiting for Jesus. They were waiting to be arrested themselves. They were waiting to steel themselves for the possibility that they too might be crucified. After all, it happened all the time. None of this was part of the plan. But then came the first day of the week, and that wasn't part of the plan either, was it? Because Jesus lives. And he showed up to them where they were hiding, like lost sheep without a shepherd. And he comforted them. But Thomas was missing. So Jesus came back. He came back when he knew that Thomas would be there, so that every single one of his followers knew he was alive. And it was so important that they did, because Jesus has plans. Now, I would have thought this would be the beginning of something amazing, right? Jesus is alive. I was right with the world. Let's go, boys. But nope. Today's reading shows us something different. Even though the guys had seen the resurrected Christ twice, it did not seem to matter. They were physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually exhausted. They probably felt a little foolish as well. After all, as Peter had once said, they'd left everything to follow him, and now it was all gone, resurrected Christ or not. So what did they do? They went back to the old and familiar ways before they knew Jesus. Peter, that rock on which Christ promised to build his church, he went fishing. He had failed Jesus by his denials when Jesus needed him the most. So perhaps he's just going to have to live out the consequences of what he had done and what he had left undone. And when Peter went fishing, seven of the others followed him. Makes you wonder where the others were, doesn't it? But everyone needs a leader. So perhaps they figured Peter was as good a leader as anybody else. Let's go fishing. And when they did, they came up empty. Just one more failure and a whole list of disappointments. But then Jesus showed up, as he always does. Never how we expect or when we expect, and oftentimes when we've stopped expecting anything of Christ at all. He showed up. And we know what happened next. They caught some fish at Jesus' leadings, and they recognized the Lord, and yeah, Peter's crazy. He gets dressed and jumps in the water. It makes perfect sense. And they made it back to the beach. But did you notice one thing? There was already fish on the grill that morning. morning, and bread besides. Jesus had already prepared a meal for them, providing exactly what they needed after this terrible experience they had been going through. He offered food and fellowship so that they could rest and be renewed. Everything's going to be okay after all. But here's one more thing, and it took me a whole lot of years to notice it because I was always in a rush to get the Jesus and Peter, do you love me part. Did you notice that Jesus asked them to bring some of their miraculous catch and add it to the grill? This wasn't because Jesus hadn't counted out how many people were going to show up. I think it was because he wanted to affirm their worth as his disciples. He loved them. And he trusted them even as they trusted him. And everything is being made new. They were worthy. And being made to feel worthy can bring a huge sense of renewal. This was just what they needed. Rest from the chaos of all that had happened. Rest in the fellowship of being fed and feeding each other. Rest in the presence of the risen Lord. And with this time of rest, they would be renewed for the plans that Jesus had for them when he wasn't physically among them. Yeah, the Spirit is going to come, but it isn't on their radar screen yet. That's over a month away. What's coming? Promise now. They are promised not a return to the old ways, the old lives and the old habits. They're being invited to enter into a new thing that Christ has had planned since before the beginning of the world. They weren't exactly sure what that was, but they knew they could trust him with the future just as they had trusted him ever since they first knew him. You know, this account really resonates with me. Everything seems to be so hopeless so much of the time. We try so hard, but it never seems to work out exactly the way we thought it would. People can be so mean. Life can be a constant roller coaster, and I don't know about y'all, but I'm scared of speed and heights, so it never works well for me. We often just want to give in, give up, and do what is familiar. Be prepared to settle for what we know rather than trusting in an untried and unfamiliar way. And it can be scary. But what did John read this morning? God has plans. As long as you are breathing, you're not just breathing to take up space. God has plans for you in this place. And in the world, God has plans for every single man, woman, and child in this place. Plans for all who have served the Lord at Sudley and continue to serve no matter what's going on around us, just to focus on the plan. Because God's plans give us a future with hope. But first, we have to rest. So if you are willing, I would like to try something. Just for a moment, close your eyes and put your hands in your lap. And while you do so, if you feel any tension in the next several moments, I invite you to allow your hands to sense that tension. And consider what I'm about to say. Consider the fact that the whole world seems to be on fire with anger and fear and judgment, and there seems to be nothing we can do about it. Our country is divided against itself, No one is listening to any voices beyond those in their own echo chambers. Our community struggles with brokenness in our homes, our schools, our places of business. Our church is still reeling from the aftermath of schism. We've lost friends and family members in the midst of divisiveness and chaos. We are exhausted mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We try to go back to the old ways, but nothing seems to work. And now, I would invite you to hear these words that Jesus spoke to those he loved. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Now open your eyes and breathe in the renewing life and hope found in Christ, and hear this truth. He's got this because he's got us. And now I think it's time for all of us to come meet. And to God be the glory. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves his love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Now this morning, as you pass the peace, I invite you to just share the peace of Christ with those in your pew and those in front of you and behind you, because they've already been breathing all over you. So if you could just stay in your pew and pass the peace with those behind, in front of, and next to. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image. You breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. Do you hear that? His love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, Father. You made covenant to be our sovereign God, and you spoke to us through
through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you. And blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, he fed the hungry, and he ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, Father, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Spirit. So on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. And he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. As often as you eat of this loaf, do so in remembrance of me. Likewise, after the supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to the disciples saying, drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at the heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. My brothers and sisters, this is a profound symbol of God's love for each and every one of us. Now this morning, as you come to the table, we've got a little something extra, big surprise, right? When you come and after you receive the meal, you are invited to remember that you belong to him, that you are beloved, that you are made worthy through Christ, and that he has plans for you. And so after you receive the bread and receive the cup, I invite you to, if you want, and take as many as you want, because I always get too many of everything, take one or more of the stones that have been placed in this container and take it home with you so you remember. When the times are tough, he's got you. And he's got plans. And he will never ever leave us, forsake us, or set us up to fail. And it's important, so important to remember. So, I think it's time to eat. Oh, one more thing. If you need gluten-free, please let... Thank you.
Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let's rise.
I am the
the yoke. When he says, his yoke is light, his burden is easy. When they yoked little calves, and y'all probably know this, I did, but when they would yoke oxen together, they would put a grown-up oxen who knew what to do with a baby oxen. And the baby oxen, if he went too fast, he got chafed. If he went too slow, he fell on his bottom. He had to go just right. And as long as we're going just right with the Lord we're yoked with, we're going to be good. So when you go into the world today knowing that you're not alone, you go with the Father through the presence of the Son in the power of the Spirit. And you got to be happy about that. So I want y'all to leave this place with a smile on your face, not just because I stopped talking. So go forth with God. He's got this, because he's got us. And to God be the glory. Amen.
Amen.
Have a glorious day.